Recorded Books presents The Fox by D.H. Lawrence, narrated by Sheri Blair.
The two girls were usually known by their surnames, Banford and March. They had taken the farm together, intending to work it all by themselves. That is, they were going to rear chickens, make a living by poultry, and add to this by keeping a cow and raising one or two young beasts. Unfortunately, things did not turn out well. Banford was a small, thin, delicate thing, with spectacles. She, however, was the principal investor, for March had little or no money. Banford's father, who was a tradesman in Islington, gave his daughter the start, for her health's sake, and because he loved her, and because it did not look as if she would marry. March was more robust. She had learned carpentry and joinery at the evening classes in Islington. She would be the man about the place. They had, moreover, Banford's old grandfather living with them at the start. He had been a farmer. But unfortunately, the old man died after he'd been at Bailey Farm for a year. Then the two girls were left alone. They were neither of them young, that is, they were near 30, but they were certainly not old. They set out quite gallantly with their enterprise. They had numbers of chickens, black leghorns and white leghorns, Plymouths and Wyandots, also some ducks, also two heifers in the fields. One heifer, unfortunately, refused absolutely to stay in the Bailey Farm closes. No matter how March made up the fences, the heifer was out, wild in the woods, or trespassing on the neighboring pasture, and March and Banford were away, flying after her, with more haste than success. So this heifer they sold, in despair. Then, just before the other beast was expecting her first calf, the old man died, and the girls, afraid of the coming event, sold her in a panic, and limited their attentions to fowls and ducks. In spite of a little chagrin, it was a relief to have no more cattle on hand. Life was not made merely to be slaved away. Both girls agreed in this. The fowls were quite enough trouble. March had set up her carpenter's bench at the end of the open shed. Here she worked, making coops and doors and other appurtenances. The fowls were housed in the bigger building, which had served as barn and cowshed in old days. They had a beautiful home and should have been perfectly content. Indeed, they looked well enough, but the girls were disgusted at their tendency to strange illnesses, at their exacting way of life, and at their refusal, obstinate refusal, to lay eggs. March did most of the outdoor work when she was out and about, in her puttees and breeches, her belted coat and her loose cap. She looked almost like some graceful, loose, balanced young man, for her shoulders were straight, and her movements easy and confident, even tinged with a little indifference or irony. But her face was not a man's face, ever. The wisps of her crisp, dark hair blew about her as she stooped. Her eyes were big and wide and dark. And when she looked up again, strange, startled, shy and sardonic at once. Her mouth, too, was almost pinched, as if in pain and irony. There was something odd and unexplained about her. She would stand balanced on one hip, looking at the fowls pattering about in the obnoxious fine mud of the sloping yard, and calling to her favorite white hen, which came in answer to her name. But there was an almost satirical flicker in March's big dark eyes as she looked at her three-toed flock pottering about under her gaze, and the same slight dangerous satire in her voice as she spoke to the favored Patty, who pecked at March's boot by way of friendly demonstration. Fowls did not flourish at Bailey Farm, in spite of all that March did for them. When she provided hot food for them in the morning, according to rule, she noticed that it made them heavy and dozy for hours. She expected to see them lean against the pillars of the shed in their languid processes of digestion. And she knew quite well that they ought to be busily scratching and foraging about, if they were to come to any good. So she decided to give them their hot food at night, and let them sleep on it, which she did, but it made no difference. War conditions, again, were very unfavorable to poultry keeping. Food was scarce and bad, and when the daylight saving bill was passed, the fowls obstinately refused to go to bed as usual about 9 o'clock in the summertime. That was late enough, indeed, for there was no peace till they were shut up and asleep. Now they cheerfully walked around without so much as glancing at the barn until 10 o'clock or later. Both Banford and March disbelieved in living for work alone. They wanted to read or take a cycle ride in the evening, or perhaps March wished to paint curvilinear swans on porcelain with green background, or else make a marvelous fire screen by processes of elaborate cabinet work. For she was a creature of odd whims and unsatisfied tendencies. But from all these things, she was prevented by the stupid fowls. One evil there was greater than any other. Bailey Farm was a little homestead, with ancient wooden barn and low-gabled farmhouse, lying just one field removed from the edge of the wood. Since the war, the fox was a demon. He carried off the hens under the very noses of March and Banford. Banford would start and stare through her big spectacles with all her eyes as another squawk and flutter took place at her heels. Too late. Another white leghorn gone. It was disheartening. They did what they could to remedy it. When it became permitted to shoot foxes, they stood sentinel with their guns, the two of them, at the favored hours. But it was no good. The fox was too quick for them. So another year passed, and another, and they were living on their losses, as Banford said. They let their farmhouse one summer and retired to live in a railway carriage that was deposited as a sort of outhouse in a corner of the field. This amused them and helped their finances. Nonetheless, things looked dark. Although they usually were the best of friends, because Banford, though nervous and delicate, was a warm, generous soul, and March, though so odd and absent in herself, had a strange magnanimity, yet in the long solitude they were apt to become a little irritable with one another, tired of one another. March had 4/5 of the work to do, and though she did not mind, there seemed no relief, and it made her eyes flash curiously sometimes. Then Banford, feeling more nerve-worn than ever, would become despondent, and March would speak sharply to her. They seemed to be losing ground, somehow, losing hope as the months went by. There alone in the fields by the wood, with the wide country stretching hollow and dim to the round hills of the White Horse, in the far distance, they seemed to have to live too much off themselves. There was nothing to keep them up, and no hope. The fox really exasperated them both. As soon as they had let the fowls out in the early summer mornings, they had to take their guns and keep guard. And then, again, as soon as evening began to mellow, they must go once more. And he was so sly. He slid along in the deep grass. He was as difficult as a serpent to see. And he seemed to circumvent the girls deliberately. Once or twice March had caught sight of the white tip of his brush, or the ruddy shadow of him in the deep grass, and she'd let fire at him. But he made no account of this. One evening March was standing with her back to the sunset, her gun under her arm, her hair pushed under her cap. She was half watching, half musing. It was her constant state. Her eyes were keen and observant, but her inner mind took no notice of what she saw. She was always lapsing into this odd, rapt state, her mouth rather screwed up. It was a question whether she was there, actually consciously present, or not. The trees on the wood edge were a darkish, brownish green in the full light, for it was the end of August. Beyond, the naked copper-like shafts and limbs of the pine trees shone in the air. Nearer, the rough grass, with its long brownish stalks all agleam, was full of light. The fowls were round about. The ducks were still swimming on the pond under the pine trees. March looked at it all, saw it all, and did not see it. She heard Banford speaking to the fowls in the distance, and she did not hear. What was she thinking about? Heaven knows. Her consciousness was, as it were, held back. She lowered her eyes and suddenly saw the fox. He was looking up at her. Her chin was pressed down, and his eyes were looking up. They met her eyes, and he knew her. She was spellbound. She knew he knew her. So he looked into her eyes, and her soul failed her. He knew her, and he was not daunted. She struggled. Confusedly, she came to herself and saw him making off with slow leaps over some fallen boughs, slow, impudent jumps. Then he glanced over his shoulder and ran smoothly away. She saw his brush held smooth like a feather. She saw his white buttocks twinkle, and he was gone softly, soft as the wind. She put her gun to her shoulder, but even then pursed her mouth, knowing it was nonsense to pretend to fire. So she began to walk slowly after him, in the direction he had gone, slowly, pertinaciously. She expected to find him. In her heart, she was determined to find him. What she would do when she saw him again she did not consider, but she was determined to find him. So she walked abstractedly about on the edge of the wood, with wide, vivid, dark eyes, and a faint flush in her cheeks. She did not think. In the strange mindlessness, she walked hither and thither. At last she became aware that Banford was calling her. She made an effort of attention, turned, and gave some sort of screaming call in answer. Then again she was striding off towards the homestead. The red sun was setting. The fowls were retiring toward their roost. She watched them, white creatures, black creatures, gathering to the barn. She watched them spellbound, without seeing them. But her automatic intelligence told her when it was time to shut the door. She went indoors to supper, which Banford had set on the table. Banford chatted easily. March seemed to listen in her distant, manly way. She answered a brief word now and then. But all the time she was as if spellbound. As soon as supper was over, she rose again to go out, without saying why. She took her gun again and went to look for the fox, for he had lifted his eyes upon her, and his knowing look seemed to have entered her brain. She did not so much think of him, she was possessed by him. She saw his dark, shrewd, unabashed eye looking into her, knowing her. She felt him invisibly master her spirit. She knew the way he lowered his chin as he looked up. She knew his muzzle, the golden brown and the grayish white. And again she saw him glance over his shoulder at her, half inviting, half contemptuous and cunning. So she went, with her great startled eyes glowing, her gun under her arm, along the wood edge. Meanwhile the night fell, and a great moon rose above the pine trees. And again Banford was calling. So she went indoors. She was silent and busy. She examined her gun and cleaned it, musing abstractedly by the lamplight. Then she went out again, under the great moon, to see if everything was right. When she saw the dark crests of the pine trees against the blood-red sky, again her heart beat to the fox, the fox. She wanted to follow him with her gun. It was some days before she mentioned the affair to Banford. Then suddenly one evening she said, "The fox was right at my feet on Saturday night." "Where?" said Banford, her eyes opening behind her spectacles. "When I stood just above the pond." "Did you fire?" cried Banford. "No, I didn't." "Why not?" "Why, I was much too surprised, I suppose." It was the same old, slow, laconic way of speech March always had. Banford stared at her friend for a few moments. "You saw him?" she cried. "Oh, yes. He was looking up at me, cool as anything." "I tell you," cried Banford, "the cheek! They're not afraid of us, Nellie." "Oh, no," said March. "Pity you didn't get a shot at him," said Banford. "Isn't it a pity? I've been looking for him ever since. But I don't suppose he'll come so near again." "I don't suppose he will," said Banford. and she proceeded to forget about it, except that she was more indignant than ever at the impudence of the beggar. March also was not conscious that she thought of the fox, but whenever she fell into her half-musing, when she was half-rapt and half-intelligently aware of what passed under her vision, then it was the fox which somehow dominated her unconsciousness, possessed the blank half of her musing. And so it was for weeks and months. No matter whether she had been climbing the trees for the apples, or beating down the last of the damsons, or whether she'd been digging out the ditch from the duck pond, or clearing out the barn, when she had finished, or when she straightened herself and pushed the wisps of her hair away again from her forehead, and pursed up her mouth again in an odd screwed fashion much too old for her years, there was sure to come over her mind the old spell of the fox, as it came when he was looking at her. It was as if she could smell him at these times, and it always recurred at unexpected moments, just as she was going to sleep at night, or just as she was pouring the water into the teapot to make tea. It was the fox. It came over her like a spell. So the months passed. She still looked for him unconsciously when she went toward the woods. He had become a settled effect in her spirit, a state permanently established, not continuous, but always recurring. She did not know what she felt or thought. Only the state came over her as when he looked at her. The months passed. The dark evenings came, heavy, dark November, when March went about in high boots, ankle-deep in mud, when the night began to fall at 4 o'clock and the day never properly dawned. Both girls dreaded these times. They dreaded the almost continuous darkness that enveloped them on their desolate little farm near the wood. Banford was physically afraid. She was afraid of tramps, afraid lest someone should come prowling around. March was not so much afraid as uncomfortable and disturbed. She felt discomfort and gloom in all her physique. Usually the two girls had tea in the sitting room. March lighted the fire at dusk and put on the wood she had chopped and sawed during the day. Then the long evening was in front, dark, sodden, black outside, lonely and rather oppressive inside, a little dismal. March was content not to talk, but Banford could not keep still.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.